To keep caribou from going locally extinct, we needed short-term actions to manage them.
We thought it would be important for decision makers to consider all possible tools in the tool belt when it comes to recovering caribou. And not all of those tools have been tested.
My name's Doug Hurd. I'm a consulting ecologist with my small company, Tithonus Wildlife Research. I'm also an adjunct professor at the University of Northern British Columbia in Prince George. And I've been studying caribou around Canada for over 40 years.
My name is Kathy Zimmerman, and I work for the provincial government of British Columbia in the Ministry of Environment and Climate Change Strategy. My title is Caribou Recovery Science Lead, and that means I have the honor of leading an incredible team of over 20 biologists across the province to ensure we have the science needed to support recovery actions for caribou.
I conceived and designed this study based on my interest in predation risk. We were motivated to do this study because most caribou in British Columbia were declined. And we understand that the major cause of that decline was landscape change, primarily logging, that led to the increase in moose numbers and, coincidentally, the increase in wolf numbers, and incidental predation on caribou was not sustainable. Addressing the problem of landscape change will take decades. And so we needed a short-term management option that would keep caribou from going locally extinct. We thought that supplemental feeding might be that solution. The effect of nutrition on limiting caribou populations had primarily been studied by looking at winter food, and we thought it might be spring and summer food that may be more important. If summer nutrition was limiting, then providing supplemental food should increase population growth. And if supplemental feeding increased population growth, then it's a technique that might be applicable for managing endangered caribou populations elsewhere. Kennedy Siding, the location of this study, was long known as a place where caribou could easily be approached and seen. But many years ago, when I went with my 9-year-old son, he attempted to sneak up on these caribou, and the caribou, of course, watching him the whole time. But it emphasized to me how great a place this would be to conduct a more in-depth study of caribou ecology. Because for the most part, caribou are very difficult to observe because of their low densities and generally occupying remote locations. This study took place on the McLeod Lake Indian Band traditional territory. And with their support, we designed this study by having them build the feeders, take those feeders to the fall range of the Kennedy Siding caribou herd, and go every 2 or 3 days and put the pelleted supplemental food in the feeders to make sure they were continually full. And they did that every few days for 3 months in the fall for 6 years.
So the next part of the study was to identify individuals using the trail camera images that we captured. So we looked at each image and could identify individuals by their antler structure, their age, and their sex. And this provided us with really accurate population estimates that we could then compare annual growth rates both before and after feeding started, as well as comparing growth rates to the adjacent quintet caribou herd that did not receive supplemental feeding. It's important to note that for both herds, wolves were concurrently being reduced through the province's caribou recovery program to about 80% during years 2 to 6 of the project to also support population growth. So the equal application of that treatment across the two herds also allowed us to be able to make those comparisons.
Before feeding began, both caribou populations were declining. The Kennedy Siding herd was declining at 9% a year, and the quintet herd 5% a year. And then, after the first year of feeding, the Kennedy Siding herd increased 6%. Over the next 4 years, when there was wolf reduction on both caribou herds, but feeding only at Kennedy Siding, the Kennedy Siding herd grew at 16% per year over those 4 years, and the quintet herd at 8% per year. So that higher growth rate at Kennedy Siding, we attributed to the effect of supplemental feeding. The second part of our study was to determine body condition. We did that primarily by measuring body weight. We set up a platform scale and we baited caribou with salt to walk onto the platform scale, where we had a trail camera trained on the scale, the caribou, their antlers, so we knew the weight of each individual caribou.
One of the aspects that we looked for, in addition to the weight itself, was the presence of visible ribs. And we did find that 27% of female caribou had visible ribs, indicating they were in poor body condition for that time of year. In addition, females with visible ribs weighed 7 kilograms less on average than those without visible ribs. This suggests that summer nutrition was limiting some caribou's ability to put on as much fat as would be expected under ideal summer foraging conditions. If caribou had enough food already, this extra feeding would not likely have had this effect. We're recommending continued and further application of supplemental feeding in this herd and potentially other herd areas where it's feasible and where it could support recovery efforts. It's important to recognize that this could be another option that helps prevent local extinctions. It's relatively inexpensive and it's minimally invasive. And it's also been a great way to engage the local First Nations community. High-intensity projects like this and predator reduction are like emergency room blood transfusions. We need these short-term measures to help stop the decline of caribou and the risk of local extinction, to help us bridge the gap as we work towards getting habitat into a condition that's needed for our long-term recovery. For caribou conservation to truly be effective and for herds to reach self-sustaining levels, we need to address as many of the risks along that path as possible.
Our work demonstrates the value of taking an experimental approach to evaluate the recovery options for not just caribou, but for all endangered species.
Management decisions need to be firmly based on science, and it's research like this that informs us about the effectiveness of potential recovery actions.